Hello and welcome to One Cool Thing. I'm Alex Colon and I'm here with Jim Fisher. And today we are going to be talking about the DJI FPV Combo. This is DJI's latest drone and it's also DJI's first racing drone. Now, Jim, you've been checking it out for a couple of weeks now. Do you want to just start by giving us a general overview?
Sure. It is a quadcopter aircraft, very similar in concept to DJI's smaller folding Mavic Cinema series, but instead of being made for smooth aerial video, it's really built to go fast. The camera is more GoPro style than cinema camera style, so it only shoots at 60 or 120 frames per second, depending on if you want to shoot at 4K or 1080p, and it goes real, real fast. And it's made to be used not with a remote control and phone screen like most drones, but you're supposed to wear these guys, this headset to see through the camera view. So you get a first person perspective, which mixed with the wide angle camera, which is mounted in the nose, it really lets you navigate through tighter spaces than you would with a traditional drone at much faster speeds.
Okay, so I think my first question, seeing that headset, when you're wearing that, that means that you're not able to actually keep track of the drone in the sky.
That's correct. To legally use the drone with the headset, you do need to have a spotter with you, which is one of the reasons I didn't do a lot with it. I mostly used the headset to make sure the camera's running and look through and make sure everything's up and running, took it off and then flew the drone by sight like I would with others, which did limit me. I couldn't really fly through tiny spaces with it. And I did end up crashing it maybe because of that at one point, but that was also a little bit of user error on the emergency brake, which we'll talk about when we get in a little more into the safety features.
Yeah, I definitely want to talk about that crash, but I want to talk a little bit more about those goggles. So When you're wearing them, what exactly are you seeing through them, and how is that different than when you're using a phone screen for, you know, a more typical drone?
Well, you get the camera view. You get the wide angle camera view without any sort of distortion correction. The camera has the fisheye distortion look. The footage the drone records will get rid of the fisheye look, so you don't have to worry about that. But you'll see the full immersive camera view. So you see the propellers. You see the kind of see just as if you were flying a plane in a video game on your TV screen. You see the same thing, but it's right in front of your eyes. And the quality of the goggles is pretty good. I'm not good with VR in general. It makes me a little nauseous and motion sick, but I put them on. I noticed some color fringing and errors, you know, issues around the edges of the frame, but the center where you're looking is very sharp. That's very low latency and very smooth refresh rate. So you get a good sense of motion through them, but you lose the sense of the outside world. So if someone wanders into your set, whatever it may be, and you don't have a spotter with you, you're in real danger of injuring them.
Okay, so you said, you know, if you're used to using VR goggles, you'll be fine. But if you're the kind of person who gets nauseous after a few minutes, is that going to be the same scenario here?
Yeah, I didn't speak to him, but I read David Cardinal, who writes for our sister site Extreme Tech, mentioned this in his copy as well, that he was good for, he has a little more VR experience than I do. He said he was good for one drone flight, whereas he can do, you know, 20 to 30 minutes of VR video gaming without an issue, but really one drone flight, 10 minutes, and then he needed to take a break.
Now, when you say one drone flight, 10 minutes, is that the battery life, or what sort of battery life are we talking about here in general?
It's rated for 20 minutes. I flew it. I was getting a little bit less in reality, but it depends on what you're doing with it. I had it hovering for a while to take some product shots. Hovering actually eats up the battery more than moving it forward. I would say expect to get 15 to 20 minutes, depending on how you fly it and what conditions you fly it in. Wind is a factor, of course.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now, when I think of DJI drones, or at least all the ones that we've reviewed so far, I think about the camera. I mean, you know, most people are using the drones that we've tested, you know, for all different reasons, you know, making actual movies, just, you know, YouTube things. What is the camera like here? Is that a big part of the experience?
It is and it isn't. It's not about the camera. It's got a very good camera for what it is. It's very much an action cam on a drone, not a pro camera. So you don't get as much dynamic range in the video. Like I was shooting into the sun and the shadows were crunched and then the highlights were preserved. They weren't clipped. They weren't blown out. But you couldn't see really anything in the shadows, whereas DJI's Mavic series the Mavic Air 2 has HDR video where you could take the same shot and really kind of get that. The other issue is the stabilization. This is a single axis gimbal, which means it steadies the camera up and down. I can say it right here. It steadies the camera up and down, but it doesn't steady it from side to side. So when I do a quick turn, actually in my footage, it will bank like you're getting a first person view of an airplane banking. Whereas a traditional camera drone, which actually got one right here, I have the Parrot Anify, which is also a very nice, another small drone with a three axis gimbal. And this has got a very, very small camera, but one that does HDR, and it's got a three axis gimbal. So it's stabilized on every axis. So if I turn, the horizon stays level and the footage is very, very smooth and cinematic. We'd say Steadicam like, whereas the footage here, I would say is more POV style. The things you would see like in a Sam Raimi Evil Dead horror movie, kind of those POV shots are the type you would get with this, with the FPV combo. But I really think that people buying this are more interested, or at least the way it's being marketed and the way I'm seeing it, more interested in the flight experience, and the actual video is a nice to have.
Okay, so if you are looking for a drone for photography, you will probably want to go with a different model.
Yeah, this is something that is for people with more experience FPV racing. I think the speed is really not, there are some beginning modes, but I think you should really spend some time with something slower. This shouldn't be your first drone.
What is the top speed on this drone? How did you test it? And you know, what if someone did want to buy it to use it for racing, do you think that this would work well for them?
So there are three main flight modes as far as speed goes. Normal, which is the default, sport, and manual. Normal mode uses these obstacle detectors on the front to slow the drone down and stop you from crashing. You can see in my footage, there's a point where I go up to some like football tackling pylons, and in normal mode, and the drone kind of just stops and pauses there, and then I end up taking it up in the air to get some different look. That's up to 31 miles per hour, which is still pretty speedy. It's faster than what the Mavic Air 2 does in its normal mode, which I think is 26 mph. So it's a little bit faster than the typical DJI camera drone, and you're typically flying closer to the ground, which also adds to the sense of motion. In sport mode, the obstacle sensors get turned off. You still get all the automatic flight assist that the drone has. It's got GPS, it's got automatic stabilization. It will hover and fly itself if you let go of the sticks. And that bumps the speed way up to around 60 miles per hour, I believe it's 62. And that's real fast. You know, it's twice as fast. And then there's manual mode, which I did not try. That requires you to constantly give the drone throttle to keep it up in the air. That's where it can go from 0 to 60 in 2 seconds and can top out at 87 miles per hour, which is real, real fast. And I just didn't have the space to safely try that, nor the experience to maybe keep the drone aloft.
Right. So, go ahead. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
You're gonna segue into talking about that. That's one thing that separates the FPV combo from other racing drones is that it is ready to fly out of the box. Whereas many folks who are really invested in this hobby have been building their own drones for years. They've been by taking circuit boards and motors and soldering and all of this stuff and homebrewing their cameras. And that's a really cool hobby, and that adds some sort of sense of personal responsibility to what you're doing. Whereas this is something you can buy with a credit card, get it up in the air and take it out real fast without any sort of training.
So thinking about the various speeds that are possible, and knowing that you didn't even test it in manual mode, which is the highest speed, you did still manage to crash it, as we said earlier. So how exactly did that happen?
User error. I'm gonna own this one 100%. I actually had, you know, emailed the PR rep and said, I'm so sorry I crashed the drone. It's totally my fault. The remote control here is nice. It does not have a phone clip because there's really no way to view the drone footage on your phone, but it's got some bumper buttons here, and there are a few of them. There's a little wheel to adjust the camera tilt. And there's this guy here, the pause hover button. If you tap this once, it's your emergency brake. It'll take it out of sport or manual mode, switch to normal mode, hover the drone in place as an emergency brake. And I was trying just to test that feature out, and I managed just to hit the other button. on the other button, on the other bumper on the side. I think I should hit the start stop button, which is another, if you tap this, it does nothing, but if you hold it down, it will stop the motors. And I tapped that instead because it said start stop instead of hover pause. And it was just.
But I mean, the good news is the drone itself didn't actually break, correct?
It didn't. It is repairable. You can buy a lot of the different components. I went nose first into just an embankment. It's soft. Thankfully, the ground was pretty soft from the melted snow. And it flipped over and the propellers kept spinning for a minute, but I got them turned off and went up the hill and picked up the drone. No real damage. When I got home, I turned it back on and the camera was freaking out a little bit. It was going up and down, but I took an air blower and just got some dirt out of the gimbal and it's fine. If I had broken the camera, DJI told me they could send me a new one and I could take a Torx screwdriver and take this thing apart and put a new one on there. And that's one of the components they are offering. If you really total it though, and you can send it in for repair. You don't have to repair it yourself.
Okay, so we know that it is well built, but it is also possible to repair.
Yeah.
Okay, so finally, I would like to touch on, again, knowing how fast it goes, what are the FAA safety requirements here?
As far as where you can fly it and who covers the regulations, this falls under the same FAA rules as any other drone. If you're flying outdoors, you need to keep it under 400 feet away, 5 miles away from airports, and you need to have an FAA registration number as a hobbyist or a Part 107 license as a, if you're gonna make money with it.
Okay, and so just as a sort of wrap up, I'd like to point out, we have not yet put a rating on this drone. We have a very detailed write-up that you can see on pcmag.com right now, but we haven't assigned a score to it like we do for many of the other products we test. Do you want to just speak a little bit about that, Jim?
Sure. I come from the camera world. I am most comfortable with an SLR, a mirrorless camera behind the lens. The drones, I've been flying different drones from DJI and others for 5 years or so now. And I feel very comfortable recommending them based on their camera features and those slower, safer drones. This is one where I don't have a good handle on the space. I don't have the skills to fly this thing manually, which I think is what a lot of people who are really into drone racing are going to want to do. And I also have some real concerns about how it's being sold safety-wise. I just think that there should be some sort of check and balance here as to who can buy this, 18 plus maybe, driver's license, something to kind of limit who can get it. And it makes me a little hesitant to recommend it to everybody because yeah, you can buy it. You can take it up out of the box. You can get it up in the air within minutes. But there's some potential liability issues there that are kind of scary to me.
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, any drone that we test does have the ability to get you into trouble. This one, just much more so.
Yeah, no, I can certainly do some damage if I wanted to fly a Mavic or a Unique drone or a Parrot drone or any drone stupidly. It's just they're not really designed to be used like that.
Right. And now we do plan on having someone else with more drone racing experience putting it to the test and letting us know what their thoughts are. So we do intend to update our review that we have online at some point in the future. So definitely check back for that. But if you just want a very good overview of what the drone does, how the camera performs, all the different flight modes, that is currently up on pcmag.com now. And thank you for watching One Cool Thing. Please like and subscribe.